Can you be replaced? Everybody can be replaced. There's no such thing as an indispensable person. There was a poem written on that one time about the indispensable man. It says, put your arm in a bucket of water, stick it in up to the wrist, pull it out in the hole that remains is just how much you'll be missed. Stir it all you want as you enter, stir up the water galore, but take it out and in no time, it'll be much the same as before. Now the idea is that we can all be replaced. There's no one that's indispensable, but there's some people that are very hard to replace. They're the ones that earn a lot of money. Can you earn a lot of money? Absolutely. I used to have a hard time finding a job. I probably had as many jobs as everybody on this side of the room. I was not a good employee. I was a bad employee. There was three different places that I only lasted for an hour and I got fired. I was getting good at it, you know. 1 hour, how do you keep a job for an hour? Well, I could tell you because I did it. But I had all kinds of jobs. And then at 26, bang, like that, something happened in my head. Now, I'm gonna spend the next 90 minutes or so telling you what happened. And I'll tell you something else. I'm gonna show you what you have to do if you bought that program to make it work. And I'm going to show you what to do if you haven't bought the program, why you should buy the damn thing, and put it to work. Because I have many, many sources of income. Way back around 1990, I was on a flight to Kuala Lumpur from Toronto. It's 25 hours in the air from Toronto to KL. If you go any further, you're coming back. It's as far as you can go, all right? Now, I play a game. I'll show you. Something tells me to tell you again. I carry this little calculator. This has got lots of miles on it. So I'll take it, and I reduce everything to the ridiculous. I'll hit 1, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Now I got 1,000,000, right? 1 with 6 zeros. Now 1,000,000, it seems like a pretty big number to most people. It does to me. And I play with numbers all the time. 1,000,000. So what do we do? Well, rather than choke on it or throw it away, let's break it down. So I'm gonna divide the 1,000,000 now by 12, because there's 12 months in a year. See, you can't think time and money at the same time, so I'm just gonna think money. Now I realize I gotta do this 12 times, I don't have to do it once. Now I'm down to 83,333. Now that's a lot less than 1,000,000. But it's still quite a bit, because now I gotta do it every month. So I take that and I divide that by 4.3, because there's 4.3 weeks in a month. Now I'm down to 19,379. But I gotta do that every week. That seems like quite a bit. I'll divide that by 2. I'm reducing it to the ridiculous. Now I'm down to 9,689, okay? It's still quite a bit. If I gotta do that between Monday and Wednesday, and again between Wednesday and Monday. I think I'll divide that now by 86. You say, why 86? I just arbitrarily picked it. I could have picked 68, right? Now, I'm down now to $112.67, okay? Let me ask you a question, Tina. If I could show you a simple way that you could earn $1,112.67 twice a week, now think of what I'm saying. I got this down to 112.67. If I could show you how to earn $1,112.67 twice a week, would you give me the 112 and keep the 1,000? I'm gonna show you how to earn $1,112.67. You're not gonna have to work very hard. It's not too much effort. Would you give me the 112 and keep the 1,000? I think you would too. Now, you see, I don't have to think of how to earn 1,000,000 anymore. I just have to think, what the hell can I get Tina doing to earn $1,112.67 twice a week? And when I've got that figured out, if she'll do it, 85 other people will do it, and I get $1,000,000 coming in. And all I've done is think. Is that a good idea? Yeah. Well, that's what he was talking about. This is it. Don't complicate it. You've got to keep it simple. Keep it really simple. Well, I was doing that on the plane, going to Malaysia. And then I wrote the 1,000,000 on top of a sheet of paper, 1 and 6 zeros. So I either work with words or numbers. And I thought, I'd earned 1,000,000 back in the 60s. And somebody says, how'd you earn it? I earned it cleaning floors. I don't think it matters what you do, it's how you do it. And I got thinking, what's so different about people that are, so I thought of a few people I knew had earned a million, and I started to write their names down, and then I started to get excited about it because I figured it out. They don't have one source of income. He said multiple systems. I called it multiple sources. Bob Allen picked it up and called it multiple streams. But I was on the plane, and I got excited. When I got off the plane, I didn't pay any attention what time it was in America. I phoned Mark Victor Hansen down in Newport Beach, and I said, Mark, I got an idea. Let's teach people to earn $1 million. We'll put on a program last week. So anyway, he phoned Jack Canfield, and then we phoned Lee Poole up in Vancouver. Yeah, we got a group of us together, and we did this 7 or 8 times. We all had our own company, so we quit doing it and started to do our own thing again. And that's where the Chicken Soup for the Soul books came from. Now, you know, I remember, even it doesn't even matter if you're in the business, Hansen has this idea. He said, you know, we're going to write a book, and some girl over in Philadelphia said you should call it Chicken Soup for the Soul. And Jack came and says, Proctor, you got a lot of stories, here's some stories. And then Hansen said, we're going to sell 50 million of these by the turn of the century. And I'm thinking, you know, he's really smoking something. If you sell 1 million books, you're on fire. 50 million. Well, they didn't sell 50 million. They sold 74 million. They've sold over 100 million. Then they sold out to Disney for millions of dollars. It was just an idea. They didn't do anything. They didn't write the books. Somebody else wrote the books. They sent in the stories. Now, eventually, they started to pay them for the stories, but they never paid them for the stories in the first books. Multiple streams. See, if you start thinking, that's what most people don't do. I spent 5 years working with Earl Nightingale. He said if most people said what they were thinking, they would be speechless. And I'm inclined to agree with him. You know, there was a great educator down in Kentucky, Dr. Ken McFarland. He said 2% of the people think, 3% think they think, and he said 95% would actually rather die than think. No, you sit there and you say, well, everybody thinks. No, they don't. Start listening to the conversations that are going on. Listen, just in the restaurant. Listen to the people at the next table. It's obvious they're not thinking. They'd never say what they're saying. Stand back and watch what they're doing. They would never do what they're doing if they're thinking. There's people come in here and they'll say, that is one hell of a good idea. And they'll go home and start doing the same thing they did before. They won't act on it. On the internet. And I said, okay. Now, in every seminar, all kinds of people come up and they give me an idea. What they really want me to do is execute their idea. That's pretty common. At any rate, we put the idea together. I might have spent 2 days. But I didn't do it in 2 days. It would be a few minutes here and a few minutes there. But probably 2 days in the last year, and it has done $1 million in business. Simple idea. But it was done on the internet. Now, do you know, some of you are looking at what Sean was showing you, and you're thinking, there's got to be more to it. Well, he gave you in there. He pointed out that he didn't know how to do most of the things that he was doing. Did you remember that? Yes. You know, Andrew Carnegie talked to Napoleon Hill, and he mentored him, and he said the accumulation of great wealth calls for power. And power is acquired through highly organized and intelligently directed specialized knowledge. Now, you've got to admit, what he was talking about was highly organized and intelligently directed specialized knowledge. How many would agree with that? Okay, let me repeat what he said because there's a tag to it. He said, the accumulation of great wealth calls for power, and power is acquired through highly organized and intelligently directed specialized knowledge. But the person who accumulates the wealth does not have to be the one that has the knowledge. Now, I have earned millions of dollars. I went to high school for 3 months. They asked me to leave. I was not at all disappointed. In fact, I was probably happier than they were. I never went back to school. I had absolutely no business experience, and yet my whole life changed on a dime. You see, what you have to do is you got to make a decision. Now, some of you, how many of you have been listening to CDs and, you know, going to seminars for a long time, and you're a little frustrated because it just isn't clicking for you? How many fall into that category? Wait a minute. We got to get honest here. How many can hold their arm above their shoulder? Let me see. All right, get the other arm up. Sean, you get the wallets, all right? Now, let's try this again. How many of you have been studying personal growth, entrepreneurial skills, and that for a while, but it just isn't clicking yet? You haven't made your fortune. Let's see a show. Now, you see, there was more hands went up that time. Let's try this one more time. How many of you have been studying this kind of material for some time, but you just haven't cashed in yet? Let me see a show of hands. I see, there's more hands go up. One of the first rules is you got to get honest with yourself. See, until I get honest with myself, I was screwing up every turn of the road. I was unhappy, I was sick, I was broke. When I got honest with myself, everything started to change. Now, what is the main thing? Well, let's think about it for a moment. Here's the main thing right here. You get one bite at the apple. Now, I've studied reincarnation probably as much as anybody. But I haven't anybody proved to me that they're back for the 21st trip. You know, so far as we know, this is it. We get one life, and it's about lifestyle. And most people are not living the way they really want to live. It's about contribution. The people that get the most are the ones that give the most. Sandy Gallagher and I were up at Cy Ranch. Are you familiar with Cy Seminars, Sean? Yeah. We were up at Cy Ranch, and they have a series of seminars that are quite extraordinary, really. They have basic, which is 4 days. Then they have Cy 7, that's 7 days, that's done at a ranch. The basic's done around different countries and places. And then they have men's leadership, women's leadership. That's 10 days. It's done men separate from the women. And then they have, for the graduates, they have what's called Principia. And they do that each year. Now, I've been with them since they started to do Principia, so I go there every year for Principia. I was up there with Michael Beckwith and Ricky, who started the morning I left from the secret. Let's see, Debbie Ford was there working the same day I was working there. She's one, you know, the dark side of the light chasers. And she's got the new movie, The Shadow, brilliant gal. But they did something extraordinary. And they do things that are extraordinary at Psy. Psy seminars are, they're pretty old seminars. They've been around a long time. And they had 650 people on the ranch. It was about a 2,000 acre ranch up at Clear Lake Oaks, California. And on Tuesday night, they had school buses come and pick up 650 people. Now there was doctors and lawyers and secretaries and truck drivers. I mean, just the greatest collection of people you ever saw, and they come from all over the world. You know, they're from Korea, Australia, Europe, Israel. And the bus took them all to a dirt field in a very poor area. And this dirt field was where kids played soccer. I mean, it was dusty, dirty, it was a dirty place. And now, a soccer field's a pretty big field. 2 hours and 16 minutes later, that field was sodded. The lady that owns Psy Seminars, Jane Wilhite, she strategized the whole deal, and it was phenomenal watching this happen. It's on film, and I'll give you an opportunity to watch the film. I'll tell you later how you can do this, and a letter about it, because the next day, there was a big write-up in the newspaper. I mean, this was pretty incredible, to sod a field in 2 hours and 16 minutes, and it was all volunteers. There's the doctor working next to the secretary and so on. And that whole place was done. Now, I want you to imagine the next morning when these poor little kids come running back to school and the whole field's carpeted with nice green grass. But you know, that's going to impress them. They're going to remember that for as long as they live. That'll never leave their mind. Then it's impacted everybody in that neighborhood. Everybody that read the paper, here I am in Dublin, Ireland, not a week later, and I'm telling you about it. You're going to go tell somebody. And it was all because a lady marshaled the minds of 650 people and got them all to make a contribution. Now, the people that benefited most from this were the ones that were laying the sod. They had a phenomenal time. They had big speakers going and all kinds of jazzy music going on. I mean, it was incredible. Yeah, and I was talking to them when I was working with them the next day, you know, and the satisfaction they got out of this. You couldn't have bought the feeling that they got. So you see, it's not just about lifestyle, it's also about our contribution. It's really about how we spend our days. What did John say work was? It was bad. I mean, who wants to work? Do you know that working is the very worst way to earn money? It is. I'm not exaggerating. That's not just a cute line. Napoleon Hill said, if you are one of those people who believe that hard work and honesty alone will bring riches, perish the thought, because it's not true. He said, riches come if they come at all in response to definite demands based upon the application of definite principles and not by chance or luck. That's what John was talking about. That's exactly. Now, he said it many different ways, and he come at you all kinds of different angles, lots of slides, but that's exactly what he was talking about. Now, there's a law of compensation, and that law is very clear. It's very clear, and most people never learn it. 1% of our population earns 96% of all the money that's being earned. It is absolutely absurd when you look at it. Yet, if a person wasn't familiar, they'd say, well, I don't believe that. Well, don't believe it. It's still true. Most of what we do believe is not true. We believe that you should go to work to earn money. That is the very worst way to earn money. You should go to work for satisfaction. You provide service to earn money. Now, think of this for a moment. The law of compensation says the amount of money you earn will always be in exact ratio to the need for what you do, your ability to do it, and the difficulty there is in replacing you. Now, let's just do the same thing they did before. They won't act on it. You tell me they're thinking. See, the truth is most people, until I was 26, I don't think I originated one thought. Now you say, well, everybody thinks. No, don't confuse mental activity with thinking. There's a big difference. You've got five senses. They're like antennae sticking out of your conscious mind. And your consciousness is picking up just an enormous amount of information. It's, whoo, it's flying into our consciousness. So the mind's always busy, usually doing nothing. Take a look at the results most people get. If you're having a money problem today, you were probably having a money problem a year ago. If you're having relationships problems today, you probably were a year ago. Most people, their life doesn't change. You go right from the cradle to the casket, and they never really make it happen. You know, when their heart stops beating, it's a formality. They never really lived. Now, listen, I've studied this longer than most of you have been living. And I'm a pretty curious guy, and I'm pretty observant. And that's exactly what happens. Now, I'm going to show you something about this program later on. This is Begin Thinking into Results. Now, you get a flyer on it there, and I think it's 800 and some euros. I'm going to change that to 395 euros. I'm not going to change it again. If you come and say, could I get it for 295? The answer is no. It's 395. That program will change your life faster than anything. Now, if you really want a winning combination, get that, go buy that system, and then go home. And if you turn your television off, quit talking to anybody, just listen to what they're saying. Get into all their tutorials. Study everything they've got. Set a goal that you're going to pick up €1 million in a year. And your whole project, it might take you a year to figure it out. It might take you a year to get really sharp. Like I saw him bring that girl up here and go, you got 12 love steps. Well, I wouldn't know how to do that. And I've been screwing around with one of these computers for a long time. But you know something? I don't have to know that. And that is the girl that came up here. He knew how to do it. He didn't even know how to do it. Probably somebody else showed him how to do it. No, this is real. I'm telling you. Becoming wealthy is so simple, it's a sin that most people don't do it. Now look at this for a moment. What's preventing most people from earning the amount of money they want to earn? I was sitting back at the back, and I said to Pat, I said, you know, what he's up there talking about is so real. It is so real. How many know Frank Kern, or how many know his name? you know his name. Well, he's a bit of a giant in this business. Would you agree with that, John? And, you know, he's like the patron saint of earning money on the internet. But, you know, if you go talk to Frank, I'm going to tell you something. He will tell you long before he started to make money on the internet, he had to work on Frank. Just an ordinary guy from an ordinary background, but he started to understand himself. I was just an ordinary guy, no formal education, no business experience, things changed. Now that happens to people, but it's rare that it happens. And when it does happen, most people just sit back and they really enjoy it. I was so shocked with what happened that I wasn't content with enjoying it. I want to know what happened to me. What happened? See, I wasn't supposed to be earning a lot of money, and I was earning a lot of money. I'd been raised to believe that you gotta be really smart if you're gonna earn a lot of money. And I knew I wasn't very smart, but I was earning a lot of money. So I thought, that can't be true. Then I was raised to believe, if you don't go to school, you'll never do well in business. Well, I hadn't gone to school. I had a company that was operating in Toronto, Montreal, Boston, Cleveland, Atlanta, London, England. Presently, I have a company that's operating in 47 different countries. And I have never been to school. I thank God sometimes I didn't go. Now, I'm not against going to school. I sent all my kids to school. I said, as long as you go, I'll pay. I thought one was never going to quit. But, you see, most of what we've been taught is not accurate. Then we're raised to believe that we're different. We're not different at all. We only look different. Do you know that every person in this room has exactly the same potential? There's only one mind. There's not a few hundred minds in this room. One mind, a few hundred expressions of it. My brother lives in Southern California. I live in Toronto. My office is in Phoenix, and I hardly work in either one of those places. But I'll phone him maybe on a nice day in the summer and just say, what are you doing? I said, I'm just sitting up by the pool reading. I said, what are you doing? He said, I'm doing the same thing. I said, what's it like there? He said, it's a beautiful sunny day. He said, what's it like there? I said, a beautiful sunny day. We're 3,000 miles apart. We're sitting in the same sun. Only one sun. You can enjoy it here in Dublin. I can enjoy it in Toronto. You probably don't enjoy it here as often as I do in Trump. I mean, but what the hell? You choose to live here, you know? It's your own choice. So don't act like you're a victim. Get the hell out from under the cloud, you know? But think about this for a moment, though. You see, this is so basic. Why do people not earn the amount of money they want to live the way they choose? Well, I'm going to tell you. I'm going to explain why they don't. Then I'm going to explain how this happens, and then I'm going to tell you how to change it. And if you really pay attention, and if you're prepared to go to the edge and let go, step out, I guarantee you, your life will change. I can guarantee it, as sure as it's going to get darker tonight. Now, I can't do it for you. Pogo says, we have seen the enemy, they are us. We got to do it ourselves. Okay? Hello. We got to do it ourselves. Okay? Now, look at you. Money problems are not outside, they are inside, and they rob us of the lifestyle we deserve. Paradigms are the problem. Now you'll find all kinds of people say, well, that's not really the problem. Look, I teach mental health to psychiatrists. If you go on our website, Dr. John Mike, who is a leading psychiatrist in America, out of Florida, he said, I taught him more about the mind in 1 year than he had learned in 4 years of medical school, 5 years of psychiatric training. We were down at the breakfast this morning, a couple of people, I told them from the opposite side of the table exactly what they were like. Was I accurate or not? I hit it right on the money, didn't I? You see, you hide nothing. Everything that's going on the inside shows on the outside. I could read your personality walking by you in the hall. And I know exactly what you're like. I know exactly how to sell you. Should I sell you fast and emotional, or should I take my time with lots of facts and figures? How do you learn that? Well, you develop the awareness. You develop the awareness. Most people are programmed never to do that. Now think about this for a moment. This is so basic and it's so simple. Most people say they understand paradigms. However, their income and lifestyle stayed otherwise. If a person understood what's causing them to have the same problem over and over and over again, unless they were completely idiots, they would change it. Yes, see, we're not idiots. But we still have the same problem over and over and over. Why? We don't know why. Do you know, I went into the Prudential of America. It's the largest insurance company in the world. The largest insurance company, or was at that time. They spent millions on training. They did not know why their top people were their top people. Now, I looked at them and I said, I can tell you exactly why they're their top people. And I can show you how to get the other people to do what they're doing. Naturally, they listened to me. Even if they thought I was nuts, there was an outside chance maybe I knew what I was talking about. And the truth is, I did know what I was talking about, and their sales went up by hundreds of millions of dollars. In fact, there's a retired VP who works for our company now, Paul Hutsey. He said, Bob, I think you raised the sales there over $1 billion. And all I did was teach the people why they're doing what they're doing and how to change it. And sales, whoop! I've gone into schools where there's kids that are struggling. Some of you have kids that are struggling with grades in school. How many got a kid that's struggling with grades in school? Let me see a show of hands. Everybody's got really intelligent kids here. Well, you know, I can show you why, and the reason they're telling you is not the right reason at all. They'll tell you it's IQ, it's this or that. It's paradigms. If a kid has a problem, let's say in mathematics, what do? We cram. Get in. Cut off TV, no girls, no boys, you know, no nothing, just study. And they go to school and they have a test and the marks improve. Heat's taken off, they give the TV back, the girlfriends, the boyfriends, and whoop, numbers go right back down again. You see, what they did was just force it up, but it come back down. Because there's an inner thermostat here controlling it, it's called a paradigm. So we see that change. I've gone into state prisons in Canada. I've gone into maximum security, Kingston Penitentiary. I've had them take and tear up the parole. First of all, I had them parole people to me that were never going to leave the place. One of them, the warden called a mad dog. His name's Joe Gardner. He's gone now, and he gave me permission to tell the story, but they let him out in special parole to me. I hired him. He was the best employee I ever had. He was required to talk to the city police every week in Toronto and the Mounties, just like the national police or, you know, federal police, every month. Not allowed to leave the city. I got them to tear up his parole, give him back his passport so he could move to England and open up the office with me. So I've gone into companies, I've gone into schools, I've gone into prisons. There isn't anywhere where this doesn't work. And I'm going to tell you something, it's got nothing to do with your intellect. Nothing. You may think you're not that sharp, it'll work. You may think you're really smart, it'll still work. Yeah? And probably if you think you're not that smart, it'll be easier. All right? Now, look it. I want you to think about this. What are paradigms? Paradigms are nothing but a multitude of habits. That's really what they are, a multitude of habits. And they're other people's habits that are passed on from one generation to the next. Why do you think you're so much like your relatives? Why do you think you even look like them? Why do you think you like the same food they like? Did you decide? I was holding a little baby up the front here, 12 days old. That baby's being programmed right now. I was telling them, I said, you could teach this baby to read now. Did you know that? And they said, no, we don't know it. Well, if you don't know it, you probably won't do it. Could you do it? Yeah. You can teach that baby multiple languages. That baby's a linguistic genius at 12 days old. Most people don't know that, so they don't do it. You see, we live in absolute ignorance. We'll take babies at night and we bundle them all up tight. We want them to keep warm. Let me tell you something. Where there's no physical movement, there's no neurological development. We're slowing the kid down. We put them in a crib and we put the cover so tight we don't want them to move. We want them to get warm. What we should do is turn the temperature up in the house. We'd be uncomfortable. The baby'd be comfortable. Put them in a track on the floor around your mattress and they'll start crawling right from birth. A baby that doesn't crawl has difficulty reading. There's so many things that we don't know. And we're raising kids the same way we were raised. Why? Because we're programmed to do that. You see? And so we get all kinds of really crazy ideas going on in our mind. We've got to change them. Our programming is much like our relatives. The odds of us being really different than our parents are pretty slim. Can we be as different as day and night? But we've got to make the choice, and then we've got to do the work. Now look, paradigms shape your logic. Paradigms definitely shape your logic. I'll give you something else. Do you know that all the geniuses are dead? That's right, they're all dead. When they're alive, they're crazy. I want you to imagine that it's around 1902, and we live in Dayton, Ohio. You live on one side of the rights. I live on the other side of the rights. Now, the rights have two boys that fix bicycles. And what are they going to do? They're going to fly. Yet, so we'd be having dinner, and we'd be saying, I'm telling you, those kids are going to kill themselves. Then when they got the plane off the ground, people said, well, they're only up there for 12 seconds. Wilbur said to Orville, we not only got up there, we kept the damn thing up there for 12 seconds. How about the world? For years, we believe it was flat. I mean, it's the only logical explanation there is. I mean, how would people live on the side of it? Forget the bottom. Think about it for a moment. That's logic. It's illogical for you to believe that like that, by following some simple instructions, you could earn more money every day than your parents might have earned every month. It's hard to buy into the idea that you could actually change your income where you start earning every month what you've been earning every year. I was on a program in Lima, Peru. I flew down there. I was there for an hour and a half, got on a plane and I left. I earned more money than I would have earned on the Toronto Fire Department in 12 years. For an hour and a half. I've got to go over to Bucharest. I will earn more money at that gig in Bucharest than I would earn in 25 years on the Toronto Fire Department. That's where I was when this all started. Now think, what happened? I started to do things that were totally illogical. Totally illogical. How'd that happen? Well, for a long time I had to say, I don't know, but now I do know. If you're not prepared to do things that are illogical, you're not going to go any further than you're going. Your logic has got you wired where you are. It's totally illogical for a person that's on a job for 14 years just to up and quit. Yes, my God, what are you going to do? I'm going to start to live. Get out of my road. Think. You know that our paradigms literally control how we use our time. I'm going to start to live. Get out of my rut. Think. You know that our paradigms literally control how we use our time. Do you know that we all get exactly the same amount of time? There's no one who gets any more time than anybody else. The hobo that's sleeping on the street, they get as much time as the industrialist that's, you know, one of the most successful people on the planet. I remember having breakfast with Earl Nightingale one day. I mean, he was my mentor, my idol, and I eventually went to work with him. And whenever I was with him alone, I always had a half a dozen well-prepared questions. And we were having breakfast in downtown Chicago one day. We went down to a speaking engagement and early in the morning. He lived downtown. He said, well, why don't we go over to, I don't know, whatever hotel it was, and have breakfast. I said, absolutely, yeah, I'd like that, you know. Whenever I could get alone with him, I'd get alone with him. So we're sitting having breakfast this morning. I said, Earl, now, he was the most listened to man in the history of the broadcasting industry at the time. Earl Nightingale literally started the personal development business, he and his partner Lloyd Conant, as far as we know it today in recorded fashion. And I said, Earl, how did you learn to master time management? I could still hear his fork hitting the plate. And he looked at me and said, what are you talking about? He said, I never mastered time management. Nobody masters time management. He said, time can't be managed. He said, I merely manage activities. He said, I just keep a sheet of paper and I write things I have to do on them, and then I do them. He said, is that it? What the hell else would there be? You know, that morning at breakfast, I probably learned an idea that was worth millions of dollars to me. If I have something to do, I just write on a little sheet and I do it. Somebody asked me what I do with my spare time. I don't have any. I don't have any spare time. Andrew Carnegie was the wealthiest man in the world. He spent half his life earning money and the other half giving it away. Napoleon Hill asked him that. He said, I don't have any spare time. I don't have any free time. He says, free time, spare time is a waste of time. And he said, you only get so much. You're obligated to do everything you can with the time you've got. Do you know when you're happiest? When you're most productive. You know when you're unhappiest? When you got nothing to do. What are you doing? Nothing. No. Most people get lost watching a television set. They lose themselves in somebody else's world. We could do so much more with our time. Our paradigms control our perception. There was a lady right in the front row. She was a black lady in the seminar here just the other day. And I went up to her and I said, you probably think you're black, do you? And she looked at me like, you know, where are you coming from? And I said, well, everybody here thinks you're black. I said, my shoes are black and you're not the color of my shoes. And I said, everybody thinks I'm white. My shirt's white and I'm not the color of my shirt. Do you know if you ever saw a white person, you'd probably get scared. Like, ah, the white, look at them. You would. Why do we say they're black and I'm white? We're programmed. See, we don't even see with our eyes. We see through our eyes. We see with cells of recognition in our brain. That's why two people can look at the exact same thing. One sees something the other doesn't see. Somebody see what Sean was explaining and see, my God, this is phenomenal. And I'm going to make a decision. It looks more difficult than he's saying, but I'm going to master it. Next year this time, they'd have an enormous income. Somebody else is looking at it, that's interesting. They're not, but the idea is, you see? It's perception. It's how do you see? Like, this room looks totally different to you than it does to me. I see an acre of eyeballs out there. You see one guy and a bunch of screens. Now, that's the way it is. We're in the same room. We're looking at, you know, the same room. But we're seeing something totally different. Our paradigm controls our effectiveness. I am very effective today. I'm an effective person. When I'm working, I am very effective. No, that's not an accident. I decided to become very effective. I have studied people. I have studied why they do what they do. I have probably watched the movie Patton more times than anybody alive. George C. Scott won an Academy Award for the movie Patton, General George Patton. I watch it over and over again. And I'm not lost in the story. It's the acting, it's so phenomenal. Ed, compare that to a sales presentation. I watched that and Lawrence of Arabia. You watch Peter O'Toole or Mar Sharif in Lawrence of Arabia, it's phenomenal. Watch Peter O'Toole on that camera, on that camel, the cameras that's close up on his face. He believes he's Lawrence, he's become Lawrence. What happened? He got a script. He read the script, he reread it, he memorized it, he studied it, he internalized it, and he became Lawrence. George C. Scott became General Patton. Well, you know, you can learn something by watching these people. They're such consummate professionals at what they do. There's a good book, if you like to read, by The Art of Acting by Stella Adler. It's a phenomenon. I've got it in my case. I carry it with me all the time. I just keep reading it over and over again. The Art of Acting by Stella Adler. Thanks very much. Appreciate it. Stella Adler was one of the greatest acting coaches that ever lived. And Marlon Brando was one of her students. In fact, he wrote the foreword to the book. Now, both Marlon Brando and Stella Adler are gone now. Stella Adler never wrote a book. But she recorded all her classes, and a man named Kissel took her classes and turned them into a book. It's a phenomenal book. As you start studying this, you'll realize this is about living. This is about living. That's what acting is. Do you know that most people are extras in their own movie? They're not the star of their own movie. We should be the star in our own movie. We want to study this. Really study it. There's so many wonderful lessons about life. And you start to look at what you're doing, you say, how good am I at it? Am I really a pro at this? You're supposed to have a guy here, he was here last year, Chris Guerrero. I guess he's a friend of Sean's and mine. And Chris started to listen to what I talk about. He joined our coaching program. I met some people this morning in the breakfast that are in there. We have a 13-month coaching program. If any of you are interested, I'll show you where to go. But Chris was a pretty smart guy, but he wasn't winning. He sent me a letter. He stayed in the coaching program. I think he signed up for 2 or 3 years. Each year he'd sign up again. And he sent me a letter, here maybe a year or so ago. And he said, I want you to know that I had to put 3 or 4 credit cards together to get in your coaching program. But he said, I just had my first $1 million month. Here's a guy that was earning $1 million in a month. Most people couldn't conceive of earning $1 million in 10 years. Why? It boils down to effectiveness. Chris started to learn things about himself and he started to become more effective. Now, our paradigm controls our productivity. If your productivity translates into income, does that mean that you can only earn so much that you're trading time for dollars? No. You saw what he was showing you. Set up affiliate sites. Sell stuff for other people without ever even talking to them, and they mail you checks. You know, the postman should never pass your door without leaving you a check. See, we can do this. Now, when I first started to study this, if somebody had suggested this to me, I thought, this guy's smoking something. You know, he's got shiny shoes and a fast time, but it doesn't work. But see, the truth is, it does work. I found that some of the most brilliant people in the world are broke. And I've also found people that are functionally illiterate, that could neither read nor write, are worth millions. Now, of course, there's some brilliant people that are worth millions and some people that are functionally illiterate that don't know enough to come in out of the rain. But the bottom line is, most of the things that we believe about our ability to earn money are so far from the truth that it's ridiculous. No one teaches people how to earn money. Do you know that you can go to Oxford, Harvard, Stanford? They don't teach you how to earn money. Best education in the world. Never teach you how to earn money. I'll tell you something else.